opportunity. We should be passing out the sheets of papers. Any question that you have, please address it to either the Reverend Jimmy Swaggart or Brother Ahmed Deedat. Ahmed Deedat, does the glorious Quran exist in its original and pure form? And were the originals in fact burned?
There is an Osmani Quran. You know, and the Khalifa Osman, Brother Swaggart mentioned something about variant readings, that Osman had those variant readings burnt. And to give an example from his own speech, if somebody was shorthand, right, you know, taking down notes of Brother Swaggart's speech, he mentioned a number of names. He was actually mutilating them. We forgive him because when it's an Ottoman or something like that, when it's saying Usman, he said something about Omar, which sounds most horrible. We are not taking, you know, exception to that, because this is, you are not used to the, our names. But the person who's taking shorthand and you reproduce that, you'll never be able to connect that you were talking about Osman, the third caliph of Islam, or you're talking about Omar, the second caliph of Islam, Hafsa, you pronounce it correctly. So in that case, if I was going through the notes for publication, Brother Swaggart's speech, I would, you expect me to leave it as it is? You know what, the way mutilated spelling of Ottoman, this is not Ottoman, it's Osman. So I would say my O-T-H-M-A-N instead of Ottoman. I said, look, it's O-S-M-A-N, Osman. Wouldn't I do that? So what happened is this, the books, the Hebrew scripture as well as the Arabic scripture were written originally without the vowel points, without the vowels. Hebrew without vowels, Arabic without vowels. To a native of the language, it was quite easy to understand what was being said. But to an outsider, without the vowels, you can't make the proper pronunciation. Like, for example, in English, if it was written without vowels, that the man is sleeping on the bed will be written B-D. You know it should be bed. It's not bid, it's not bod, it's not bad, it's not bud. B-D stands for bed. You know, your senses of the language makes you to substitute the vowels in your mind. B-D stands short for bed. The Arab knew that and the Jew knew that about his language. But as soon as he goes to a foreign nation, the person doesn't know how to pronounce, like the word Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, which means praise be to God, the cherisher and sustainer of the worlds. Written without vowels, how are you going to pronounce? Alhamdo, Ilhamdo, Alhamdo, how? So different nations, as soon as they started accepting Islam, the way they heard it, they started pronouncing it, they started writing it, mutilating the language. Like English. Some of my people, they pronounce divorce as divorce, divorce as divorce, iron as iron. What are you going to do? Our spelling between the English of the Englishman and the English of the American, your spelling varies, but fortunately this sound, the pronunciation is not varying. But if that produces a difference in the pronunciation, you say, no, you'll have to change it. So those variant readings of the various pronunciations, they said, look, the revelation was given in the dialect of the Quraysh, the family, the tribe of Muhammad, and that pronunciation should be preserved. So every other pronunciation with different vowel points, it says eliminate them. And that one that was done by Osman is preserved in the museum, in the Topkapi Museum in Istanbul, that is in Turkey.
Brother Swaggart, this is live. Please explain to me how in Revelation there are supposed to be 144,000 people who are supposed to enter heaven, and all of them are Jews from the 12 tribes. What happens to the Gentiles like us?
Is that your question? The 144,000, as mentioned in the book of Revelation, as the brother said, has to do with the Jewish people, 12,000 from each tribe. It has nothing to do with Gentiles. And those 12,000 are chosen from each tribe during the Great Tribulation period because they are the ones that have accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. And so they are raptured up into heaven. It has nothing to do with the salvation of the millions that have come to the Lord. It has nothing to do with the Gentiles. It just speaks of that 144,000. And it also states that whosoever calleth on the name of the Lord shall be saved. So any Gentile that would call on the name of the Lord will be saved as well. I trust that answers the question.
Brother Ahmed, Jesus said, "The Lord our God is one Lord, and you shall love the Lord with your God with all your heart." Mark 12 chapter, the 29th through the 30th verse. Muslims agree with Christians that there is only one God, but how do Muslims love God without a change of heart?
The change of heart, look at the Muslims. Look at them. Jesus said, "By the fruits you shall know them. Do men gather figs from the thistle or grapes from the thorn?" He said, "Every good tree will be a good fruit, and every evil tree will be evil fruit." Here is the test. The fruits. Islam has created the biggest society of teetotalers in the world. There are some 1,000 million Muslims in the world, and almost as a whole, they are teetotalers. They don't imbibe alcohol. Here is the fruits. My own particular race, the most racist people on earth, you know, the Hindus of India, the caste Hindus, you know, the super Brahmin caste, my nation. And you see, the same nation, the most racist nation on earth, becomes one who accepts the black and the white, the rich and the poor in his brotherhood. A change. With all these claims that are being made for Christianity, Jesus Christ transforming people's lives, you know, the old you goes out of you and the new you comes into you. I say, my dear brothers and sisters, look, in this mighty nation of America, according to Brother Swaggart, 11 million drunkards. That's what he says. 11 million drunkards and 44 million heavy drinkers, your nation. And Brother Swaggart says, "I see no difference between them." Means 55 million. He considers them to be drunkards. The only difference is that he is not going far enough. In Islam, we say even your social drinker. The Holy Quran says, but before that, the Prophet Muhammad said, "So whatever intoxicates in greater quantity is forbidden even in smaller quantity." No excuse for a nip or a tot. Out. The Holy Quran says, "Ya ayyuhallazina amanu," so all you who believe, "innamal khamru," most certainly intoxicants, "wal maisiru," and gambling. Brother Swaggart in his book on gambling says, 54 billion a year you are squandering on gambling. "Wal maisiru," "wal ansabu," and fortune telling, "wal azlamu," and idol worship, "rijzum min amali shaitan," and an abomination of Satan's handiwork, "fajtanibuhu la'allakum tuflihun," is a shun such abomination that you may prosper. And wine barrels were emptied in the streets of Medina, never to be refilled. This is the fruit. This is the fruit of this teaching. With 2,000 years of preaching, look at it. You have these powers of miracle working. Christ gives life. He heals the sick. Muhammad couldn't. In the name of Muhammad, they couldn't do it. I says, my brothers, you don't read the scriptures. Jesus Christ, he said, "For there shall arise many false Christs and false prophets who will show you great signs and wonders, if it were possible to deceive the very elect." If false Christ can do that, if false Christ can perform miracles, if false prophets can perform miracles, then I says, is this a test of your faith? No. Then Jesus Christ tells those who are doing this miraculous work, he's telling you in the Gospel of St. Matthew, that on that day, on the last day, on the day of judgment, he says, "Many will come to me on that day, saying, 'Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in thy name, and in thy name cast out devils, and in thy name do many mighty works?" In your name, in the name of Jesus, didn't you do all these things? Didn't we do all that? He said, "Yes." He said, "Then I will profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity." I said, "Yeah, explain. You." He won't tell the Jews, "Depart from me, footsack, get away, I don't know you." He won't tell the Hindus, "Get away from me," or the atheists, "Get away from me." He will tell you. I want to know why. Why would he tell you? I don't even know you. Get out. I says, look, these are not the test. John the Baptist, according to Jesus, one of the mightiest messengers of God, Jesus says, among those born of women, there has not risen another greater than John the Baptist, and yet he performed no miracles. Did he? Show me. What did he do? What miracles? No, miracle is not a test. But the greater miracle is that without any miracles, you transform nations. Nations are transformed. 1,000 million people, they don't imbibe alcohol because of the dictates of Muhammad.
Mr. Swaggart, what will happen to Muslims who believe in Jesus but do not receive him as Lord, as the Son of God, when they die?
The Bible tells us that there is none other salvation under heaven other than by the Lord Jesus Christ. Believing in Jesus, that he's a miracle worker, that he's a prophet, that he's a great teacher, is not enough. You have to accept what he did at Calvary's cross for your soul to be saved. Man labors under a terrible bondage of sin as a result of the fall. Sin is not just an act that you commit. It's not even a force, it's a nature. You cannot control that nature by cutting off a man's hand. You have to get to his heart. If all the Muslims in the world are thrilled and happy with what they have, why do hundreds of thousands of them watch my telecast? Secondly, true Christians don't drink either. What mankind must have is a change of heart. You don't deal it from the exterior. It comes from the inside. Only Jesus Christ can do that. Not drinking alcohol is not enough. Just not gambling is not enough. Just keeping rules is not enough. Christianity is really not a religion. It's not a series of do's and don'ts. You cannot earn your salvation. He paid it at Calvary's cross, totally and completely. We accept him, and then the nature of sin is broken. The person does not drink because he fears his hand will be cut off, or his toes, or his nose, or whatever. But he doesn't drink because the desire is taken away. Accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, and the gospel is to the whole world, not to just a select few, for God so loved the world. And incidentally, the word begotten also means to produce, sir. God produced his Son.
Ahmed Deedat, does the glorious Quran state that the Holy Injil is guidance for all mankind?
No, the Holy Quran doesn't say that the Injil is a guidance for mankind. Nor does the Bible say that. You see, Jesus Christ, when he sent out his disciples on the mission of preaching and healing, he instructed them. He said, go ye not into the way of the Gentiles, and into any city of the Samaritans enter ye not, but go ye rather unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. I want to know where the American Anglo-Saxons fit in as the Jews, the house of Israel. Then he's telling a Jewish woman, a Greek woman comes to him, wanting her daughter to be healed. So he turns his face away. She goes on the other side and she won't let him go. So the disciples say, help her, this woman is persistent. You know, like a drowning man clutching at straws, drowning women do the same. Heal her child. So Jesus says, I am not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel, the Jews. So they say, help her. Jesus says, do not throw the bread of the children to the dogs. Who are the dogs? The Gentiles, you and me. Every other human being other than the Jews are dogs and pigs, according to Jesus, or according to your scripture. It says, Jesus says, do not throw that which is holy unto dogs. Do not throw pearls before swine, lest they turn and rend you. Who are the dogs and who are the swine? The Gentiles. So he says, do not throw the bread of the children to the dogs. The woman in desperation, her child's life is at stake. She says, Lord, Master, even the dogs have crumbs from the Master's table. So he said, give her the crumbs. Look, this is the scripture. Unfortunately, the scripture is not being quoted. The scripture quotes what Jesus said. I'd like to hear what Jesus said. Jesus says, not about this supposed idea that you just believe and you be saved. He said, verily, verily, I say unto you, except your righteousness exceed the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, you shall by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. There's no heaven for you unless you are better than the Jew. And I'm asking, how can you be better than the Jew by not keeping the laws and the commandments? You answer that.
Mr. Swaggart, from Mr. Deedat's proof that the Bible you hold in your hand is not God's word, what proof can you prove that he's wrong? I mean proof, not just belief.
I believe I have proven it beyond the shadow of a doubt tonight that the Word of God is true. And I don't know what more proof that anyone would need. You can read the Bible and not believe it, but the Lord told us to believe it, and we would receive its many, many benefits. If one does not want to believe, irrespective of the proof that is shown, one still will not believe. The Lord said to one particular individual, if one came back from the dead, he was telling the story there in the 16th chapter of Luke. And the rich man said, send someone from the dead to warn my brothers. If one came from the dead, he wouldn't believe it if he doesn't believe the prophets that are already there. So there is no proof that one can give for unbelief, because it will not believe. That's the reason that he said, and I once again quote my favorite verse, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And I'll close with one more statement. Sir, I am proof that this is real, for he has saved my soul.
Ahmed Deedat, could you quote and give the reference from the glorious Quran stating the holy angel has been corrupted? And if not, then tell us when it was corrupted, by whom, and where exactly is it changed?
Mr. Chairman and my dear brethren, you see, I started this talk of mine with some incantation, some recitation. I was not trying to mesmerize or hypnotize you. I was actually uttering the words from the Quran, instructing us, telling us, informing us that the scriptures that the Christians are talking about, the Bible, is their own creation. I repeat what I had said, I read, and I'll give you the translation. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, in the name of God, most gracious, most merciful. فَوَيْلٌ لِلَّذِينَ يَكْتُبُونَ الْكِتَابَ بِأَيْدِهِمْ said, woe to them who write the book with their own hands, then say, this is from God. فَوَيْلٌ لِلَّذِينَ يَكْتُبُونَ الْكِتَابَ بِأَيْدِهِمْ ثُمَّ يَقُولُونَ هَذَا مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ لِيَشْتَرُوا بِهِ ثَمَنًا قَلِيلًا that they may benefit from it some small reward, like the $15 million net profit they made on the RSV. 15 million is very small compared to eternity, compared to God's, you know, goodness, his salvation is nothing, 15 million. So, وَوَيْلٌ لَهُمْ مِمَّا كَتَبَتْ أَيْدِهِمْ. So woe to them what their hands do write. وَوَيْلٌ لَهُمْ مِمَّا يَكْسِبُونَ. And woe to them for what they earn. In other words, I was proving to you all along, actually, I was giving you all a commentary on that Quranic verse without going into details because I knew time was at a premium. Originally, we had agreed to a format of an hour each, and for some mysterious reason, I was robbed of 20 minutes, so I had to cut short everything. I have so much more to give, which I'm now reserving for tomorrow night. So the thing is this now, this was actually a commentary of this situation, that this book is written with their own hands. You add in and you take out. You add in and you delete. Look, this is proof enough. The books that you have in your hand is a proof that the books have been changed. You have been changing them. And out of the 24,000 manuscripts, I say no two are identical. That's a challenge. No two of those manuscripts are identical.
Mr. Swaggart, is there anywhere in the Old Testament that says that Prophet Muhammad will come after Jesus? Thank you.
Most every religion tries to find the Bible and somewhere in their teachings and their beliefs, and so does the Quran. It tries to say that it is mentioned in the Bible or Muhammad is mentioned in the Bible. But Muhammad is not mentioned in the Old Testament. I know you're referring to the book of Deuteronomy, but he's not mentioned. That passage is referring to the Lord Jesus Christ, totally and completely. Muhammad is not mentioned anywhere from Genesis to Revelation, period.
Ahmed. What do Muslims have to say about the fact that people are healed in Jesus' name?
I have no hesitation in accepting this phenomenon, that it can happen. But these things are happening in Hinduism. People are performing miracles. In Islam, people are performing miracles. You see, in the name of a false god, you can perform miracles. Jesus Christ told that woman, if you remember, you know, the woman who had a bleeding sickness issues, 7 years, no healing, and she, while Jesus was passing by, she touched the hem of his garments and she was instantly healed. And Jesus felt that something was being drawn out of him. He looks at the woman, he says, woman, it is thy faith that healeth thee. Her faith, that she had the faith that Jesus, by touching him she got healed, is your faith. So in other words, a faith in a false god can also perform miracles. Jesus says so. For there shall arise many false prophets and false Christs, who will show you great signs and wonders. If it were possible to deceive the very elect, even the disciples of Jesus can be deceived with such miracles. So miracles is no proof at all whether the person is genuine or not.
Mr. Jimmy Swaggart, why didn't the Old Testament mention that Jesus is the Son of God? If yes, read it to me, please.
In Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14, therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. And Emmanuel means God with us. Thank you, sir.
Ahmed Deedat, who would deny that if God has preserved his word, the Torah, etc., and the holy angel in the past, he is able to preserve it always?
What I was proving to you the whole night is that the books have not been preserved. See, now you are begging the question. The books have not been preserved. If it were preserved, it would be worthy of recognition. I said, what is preserved there? The things that are there have created all the mischief. The type of book that you read as a pornography, I said, read it. My brother, look, he had 10 minutes. He had enough, more than enough time to read that little chapter of Ezekiel. I said, I dare anybody to read it to his congregation. And I tell you, I dare you, you will not read it. Reason, because it is not the word of God. If it was the word of God, you would not be ashamed of it. If God Almighty was not ashamed to reveal the details of the whoredoms of those two sisters, I am asking, why should you be ashamed? Are you holier than God? That's the implication. You are so holy that you dare not utter the words, but God Almighty uttered it. You're holier than God. I says, no. The thing is, it is not from God. See, the scriptures have been changed, and the Torah you're speaking about is not the Old Testament. You are telling us that the Bible was written by 40 different authors. Look, 40 different people wrote the book. We say when we believe, say we believe in the Torah, means the revelation that God gave to Moses. He didn't send a book down. Brother Swaggart admits that the only thing that was written by God was those tablets, and those tablets Moses destroyed them. He threw them and they broke them to pieces. These are the five books. If they were written on tablets of stone, you would need a skyscraper-sized museum to hold those stones. Where did Moses keep them? Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. Where did he keep them, those tablets of stones? No. He said, these are not the books of Moses. Moses would have no reason to belittle his brother prophet, Lot, that he committed incest with his daughters. What for? That Reuben, one of the sons of Jacob, committed incest with his mother. What for? The Judah, the father of the Jewish race, from whom we get the word Judah, from whom we get the word Judaism, that he had prohibited with his daughter-in-law by the roadside while he was on his way to Timnath. He sees this woman sitting by the wayside, and you know, he goes up to her and says, allow me to come in unto thee. She said, what will thou give me? And he said, I'll give you a kid from the flock. So what guarantee that I will give it? He says, what guarantee do you want? He says, your signet and your bracelet and your staff. And the old man gave it to her, and he cohabited with his daughter-in-law and begat twins, Fares and Zara. And they are put now in the genealogy of Jesus. That they are the great, these children of incest are the great grandfathers of Jesus Christ. Matthew chapter 1, verse 1. It says, and this is the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of Abraham, the son of David, and Abraham began Isaac, and Isaac began Jacob, and Jacob began Judas and his brethren, and Judas began Phares and Zara of Tamar. Who are these? Look at the cross-reference. It tells you Genesis chapter 38, and you find that this is the father-in-law cohabiting with his daughter-in-law, produces his children of incest, and they are honored to become the great-grandfathers of Jesus Christ. I want to know, how does this come into the book of God? How does this come into the genealogy of a man who had no genealogy?
Well, Mr. Swaggart, please address the request of Dr. Deedat to read certain passages from the Bible. I assume you mean the passages that Brother Ahmed did that challenge you to read in his presentation.
Mr. Deedat has the problem of answering questions that never were asked.
Amen.
Ezekiel 23, the word of the Lord came again unto me, saying, son of man, there were two women, the daughters of one mother, and they committed whoredoms in Egypt. They committed whoredoms in their youth. There were their breasts pressed, and there they bruised the teats of their virginity. And the names of them were Ohola the elder, and Ohalabah her sister, and they were mine, and they bare sons and daughters. Thus were their names. Samaria is Ohola, and Jerusalem Aholabah. And Ohola played the harlot when she was nine, and she doted on her lovers, on the Assyrians, her neighbors, which were clothed with blue, captains and rulers, all of them desirable young men, horsemen riding upon horses. Thus she committed her whoredoms with them, with all them that were the chosen men of Assyria, and with all on whom she doted, with all their idols she defiled her set. Neither left she her whoredoms brought from Egypt, for in her youth they lay with her, and they bruised the breast of her virginity, and poured their whoredom upon her. Wherefore I have delivered her into the hands of her lovers, into the hand of the Assyrians, unto whom she doted. These discovered her nakedness. They took her sons and her daughters. They slew her with a sword, and she became famous among women, for they had executed judgment upon her. And when her sister Aholabah saw this, she was more corrupt in her inordinate love than she, and in her whoredoms more than her sister in her whoredoms. She doted upon the Assyrians, her neighbors, captains and rulers, clothed most gorgeously, horsemen riding upon horses, all of them desirable young men. Then I saw that she was defiled, that they took both one way, and that she increased her whoredoms. For when she saw men portrayed upon the wall, the images of the Chaldeans portrayed with vermilion, girded with girdles upon their loins, exceeding in dyed attire upon their heads, all of them princes to look to, after the manner of the Babylonians of Chaldea, the land of their nativity. How much more do you want me to go? All the way? No, wait a minute. Verse 19, yet she multiplied her whoredoms in calling to remembrance the days of her youth, wherein she had played the harlot in the land of Egypt, for she doted upon their paramours, whose flesh is as the flesh of asses, and whose issue is like the issue of horses. You want me to keep reading?
I think that's enough.
Okay, wait a minute. I want my $100 now. All Muslims are truthful. Here's the $100. That man's got a pocket full of money. If he takes all that money back to South, if he takes all that money back to South Africa, he's going to worsen the U.S. debt. I don't know what kind of programs you have here in Islam, but I'm going to give his $100 to whatever you have here to help pay for this auditorium tonight.
Mr. Deedat, you made a statement that Islam believes in the virgin birth of Christ, but does not that God does not beget nor is he begotten. Luke, the first chapter, the 34th and the 35th verse, explains the birth of Christ as the Holy Spirit overshadowing Mary and the power of the Most High pouring upon her. How do you explain this?
You see, Brother Swaggart had suggested during his talk that the Quran is a copy, a plagiarism of stories from the Bible. Now, let me give you this example here, a comparison between what is told in the scriptures and what is told in the Quran about the birth of Jesus, if I may. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. In the name of God, most gracious, most merciful. وَإِذْ قَالَتِ الْمَلَائِكَةُ يَا مَرْيَمُ. Behold, the angel said, O Mary, إِنَّ اللَّهَ اصْطَفَاكِ وَطَهَّرَكِ وَاصْطَفَاكِ عَلَى نِسَاءِ الْعَالَمِينَ. That God Almighty has chosen thee and purified thee, chosen thee above the women of all nations. This is the honor that is given to Mary, the mother of Jesus, in the Holy Quran, that she is a woman chosen above the women of all nations. Ya Maryam ibnuti li rabbiki wasjudi warkai ma'a ar-raqiin. So, O Mary, worship thy Lord devoutly. Prostrate thyself and bow down in prayer with those who bow down. Dhalika min amba'i al-ghaibi nuhihi ilayka. This is part of the tidings of the things unseen which we reveal unto thee, O Muhammad, by inspiration. You were not with them when they cast lots with arrows as to which of them should be charged with the care of Mary, nor was thou with them when they disputed the point. I will not go into the full story, but if I may, I will have to do it tomorrow night. But the verses continue. وَإِذْ قَالَتِ الْمَلَائِكَةُ يَا مَرْيَمُ. Behold, the angel said, O Mary, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُبَشِّرُكِ بِكَلِمَةٍ مِّنْهُ. That God Almighty gives you glad tidings of a word from Him. إِسْمُهُ الْمَسِيحِ. His name will be the Messiah, translated Christ. Isa ibn Maryama, Jesus the son of Mary, wajihan fi dunya wal akhirah, held in honor in this world and in the hereafter. Wa min al muqarrabin, and of the company of those nearest to God. What the Christian would say, sitting on the right hand of God. We say not physically, not geographically, but in stature, in spirituality, in the company of those nearest to God. Wa yukallimu an-nasa, and he will speak to the people, fil mahdi wa kahlan, in childhood and in maturity, wa min as-salihin, and he shall be of the company of the righteous. When this good news is given to Mary about the birth of a holy son, she says, qalat rabbi anna yakunu li waladun wa lam yamsasni bashar. She said, oh my Lord, how shall I have a son when no man has touched me? The angel says in reply, qala kadhalika Allahu yakhluqu ma yasha. So even so, Allah creates what he wills. وَإِذَا قَدَى أَمْرًا, whenever he decrees a matter, فَإِنَّمَا يَقُولُ لَهُ كُنْ فَيَكُونَ. So whenever he decrees a matter, he merely says to it, be and it is. This is the Muslim concept of the birth of Jesus. For God to create a Jesus without a human father, just like that. To create a million Jesuses without father, without mother, just like that. The biblical version, in comparison, I'm suggesting to Reverend Dunkers, the head of the Bible Society in Johannesburg. I had gone there to buy an Indonesian Bible in Johannesburg, and he called me for tea, seeing this funny headgear of mine and this beard, that I was interested in Bibles. He called me into his office, and I explained this to him, which was something novel to him, something amazing to him, that I was speaking from my book. So he said, look, this and the Bible appears to me to be the same. I said, yes, on the face of it. On the face of it, we are both trying to say the same thing, that Jesus was created by a special miracle. But I said, when you compare them closely, the difference between the Quran and the Bible is chalk and cheese. I don't know whether the Americans understand this expression, chalk and cheese. The Canadians didn't, because they didn't know chalk, they knew crayon, crayon and cheese, which is not the same thing. Chalk and cheese is poles apart, worlds apart. The Quran says for God to create, he merely wills it and the thing comes into being. The Bible says, and the Holy Ghost, same question, how can this thing be when no man has touched me? Or I know not a man, meaning sexually. The Bible says, and the Holy Ghost will come upon thee, and the power of the Most High will overshadow thee. This gives that picture to the atheist and the agnostic to beat you with. How did the Holy Ghost come on Mary? How did the Almighty overshadow her, like a man doing to his wife? How? No, we know it doesn't mean that. But the language of the two. See, the Quranic language is for God to create, he wills it, and the thing comes into being. The biblical language is earthly. I said, between the two, I'm asking Reverend Dunkers, which version would you be prepared to give to your daughter? The Quranic version of the birth of Jesus or the biblical version? And believe me, he bowed his head in shame, and he said, I would prefer to give the Quranic version to my daughter.
Brother Swaggart, what did you mean by the term unique?
After I answer this, I propose, if it's not out of order, that we make this the last question. We've been here 2.5 hours.
We have 15 more minutes.
Oh, I'm sorry. Very good. Fine. They're paying him by the hour. They're not paying me at all. But I got $100, though. In the Greek translation, in the original Greek, the word unique simply meaning different than any that there had ever been. There has never been one like the Son of God. He's unique. And there has never been one like Mary that produced the Son of God, as he eloquently explained just a moment ago. It just simply means there was never one before him like that. There will never be one after him like that. He was unique as God's own son manifest in the flesh. And incidentally, we Christians don't believe in three gods. We don't believe that God is married and lives in an apartment in heaven and has a bunch of children. We don't believe and teach such foolishness as that. We believe that out of love, God Almighty condescended to come down here on this planet and live among men, and to walk and talk among men, and in human form, the incarnation, to die on Calvary's cross as the perfect sin offering for mankind. Man helpless to save himself. And he did just that, and he told the people, you kill this body, and in 3 days, I will raise it up again. Once again, he was unique in that. He was unique in the prophecies. He was unique in his birth. He was unique in his life. He was unique in his miracles. He was unique in his ministry. He was unique in his death. He was unique in his resurrection. He was unique in his ascension. And when he comes back, he will be unique in his coming again.
Mr. Deedat, we have invited you to our Christian nation to debate the topic, is the Bible the Word of God? Will you now show the courage to invite Reverend Swaggart to debate you once again on the same topic in the city of Mecca? And if not, why?
Mecca. You see, if the questioner had asked, are you prepared to debate Brother Swaggart in the United States in the different cities? I said, I'm prepared now to offer $10,000 for each meeting in places like the Madison Square Garden in New York, venues of that kind, $10,000 per meeting, 4 meetings in the United States, $40,000. But the questioner is asking whether I would be prepared to invite him to Mecca. Now, I don't rule Mecca, number one. Number two, if you want to get into Mecca, you need a visa. When I had to come to the United States, your government forced me to get a visa. And I went through the process of acquiring that visa, and I'm here. You see, I wanted to go to the old Zambia. You know, when Zambia became independent, I wanted to go to Zambia. At that time, Smith was ruling this southern Rhodesia. So they gave me visa forms, and I had to sign at the back that I do not recognize the illegitimate Smith regime before they'll give me a visa. I wanted to go, so I had to sign the document that I do not recognize the illegitimate Smith regime in southern Rhodesia. Similarly, if I have to come to the United States, I fulfill your terms and conditions. Whatever you tell me, if I'm prepared to go through with it, I get the visa. Without that, no visa in Canada, no visa here, no visa for people in South Africa. You have to fulfill the conditions. Now, there is a condition attached to you visiting Mecca. And that condition is that you declare with your lips, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. The meaning is that I believe that there is but one God, not Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, not Jesus, that God. I believe in the one and only God, Allah, which is his name, and that Muhammad is the last and final messenger of God. You fill that condition, you are welcome to come to Mecca.
Mr. Swaggart, according to your argument, the King James Version of the Holy Bible is necessary for salvation. Can we then surmise that anyone who uses Bible or another Bible will burn in hell, such as Muslims, Buddhists, Catholics, Jews, etc.?
I have never believed that you have to believe in the King James Version to be saved. That's foolishness. That's silly. And before I answer the question, if you won't let me come to Mecca, let me go on television over there. Mr. Deedat mentioned the Douay version of the Bible. Sir, we do believe in the Douay version of the Bible. Translation, let's put it that way. We do not accept those spurious books that were mentioned, but we do believe in the Douay translation. We feel it's a good translation. No one has to believe in a particular translation of the Bible to be saved. You do have to believe in the Word of God to be saved. And once again, the Word of God says, there is none other name under heaven. It also tells us that we are saved by faith, not by works, lest any man should boast. We're saved by faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And I don't care where that word is. If the Word of God, do you have a Quran over there, sir? Could I mean, I was hoping he brought one. Okay. Any word of God that's in this book, if you believe it, pertaining to salvation, you will be saved. You follow what I'm saying? If the word of God pertaining to salvation, pertaining to being redeemed, pertaining to being saved, if it's written on the side of a wall somewhere, to be frank with you, it's written on our hearts. That's what the Bible tells us. You can memorize this book and worship it, and it won't save you. It has no power to save you. But the Word of God, if adhered to, and that means accepting Jesus Christ as one's own personal Savior, if that is in the Quran, you can be saved.
Mr. Deedat, how does the Muslim account for different versions of the Quran? Does this make all of the versions lies, as you claim the Bible is?
I repeat, there is no such thing as different versions of the Quran. I said there are translations. Yours are versions. Brother Swaggart, in the previous question he answered, he said, look, there are seven spurious books in the Dua version. Seven spurious means which he rejects. So it's a version. There are seven books out of this which he is not prepared to accept as the Word of God. Whereas every Quran in the world translated, I said, it is God's Word translated. And you have a choice of words, but they are not versions. This is a version. This is a version. Chunks and chunks are thrown out from what is in here. Different version. I hope you understand my English. You know, I don't know how simpler I can put it to you. That the things are varying. What is in here? Seven books? Not in here. What is in here is not in there. What is in here is taken out from there again. Can you see? It's a version. I hope. I don't know.
Reverend Jimmy Swaggart, what is Trinity?
We believe the Word of God teaches that there is one God, not 2, 5, 10, 12, 15, one God, manifest in three persons, three different personalities. We believe there is a Heavenly Father. We believe there is God the Son. And we believe the Holy Ghost, as Mr. Deedat mentioned, that came upon Mary, is also God. They are indivisible, meaning they agree perfectly. They are one in unity. They never disagree. They never have disagreed. We believe that when you get to heaven, if you get there, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, will be seated according to the Word of God by the right hand of the Father. And will actually maintain that throne forever, basically. That's what we mean by the Trinity in a short nutshell.
We have a time exactly for two more questions. Mr. Deedat, do you believe in the Holy Ghost? Why or why not?
You see, the idea of the Holy Ghost in Christendom is that he is one in a Trinity. But the Christian says that the Father is God, the Son is God, and the Holy Ghost is God. But they are not three gods, but one God. In his catechism, he continues that the Father is Almighty, the Son is Almighty, and the Holy Ghost is Almighty. But there are not three Almighties, but one Almighty. It continues, your catechism. It says the Father is a person, the Son is a person, and the Holy Ghost is a person. That's what Brother Swaggart says in his book. Person, person, person. But not three persons, but one person. I am asking, what language are you speaking? I'm asking, is that English? By God, it is gibberish, it's not English. You see, you said person, 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 but not three person, but one person. I said, Brother Swaggart, you and your two other brothers, let's say you are three identical triplets, and we can't make the difference out between the three of you. They're all identical. We can't make out the difference. If one of you commit murder, can we hang the other? You say no. I'm asking, why not? So you tell me that he's a different person. I said, right. What makes him different? His personality. So the Father, you know, imagination, the human mind, you can't help. When you use words, they conjure up mental pictures. When you say in the name of the Father, you have a certain mental picture of that old Father Christmas, Santa Claus, millions and millions of times bigger than man, but something like a man sitting on some planet with his feet dangling onto the earth as his footstool, the heaven as his canopy, the loving Father in heaven. When you say God the Son, I'm asking, are you thinking of a prize bull or a false wahan? No. You're thinking of a handsome young man, blonde hair, blue eyes, handsome features. Something like what you saw in the King of Kings, Jesus of Nazareth, you know, or the Day of Triumph, where Jeffrey Hunter was acting. You know, handsome young man, blonde hair, blue eyes, handsome features, nice beard, not with a poly nose, with a crooked nose, that might make other pictures come into your mind. You know, Shakespeare made Shylock famous. Is it Shylock? Shylock? No. You see, so you're thinking of somebody like an Englishman or a Nordic or a German type with a straight nose, the Son. And the Holy Ghost, something that came like a dove when Jesus was baptized in the River Jordan by John the Baptist, or something that came in flames of fire at Pentecost. I said, the picture is not very vivid, but the picture is there. You have three distinct mental pictures. And however hard you try, you can never superimpose those three pictures and create one. There'll ever be three in your mind. But when I ask you how many pictures you see, you say one, you are lying to me. Brothers and sisters, you are lying to me.
Actually, we have about 3 minutes. Mr. Swaggart, this question is from the management. Do you give us permission to everyone interested in obtaining a copy of this event? Number one. Number two, why didn't you allow televising this event? And number three, we have offered this opportunity to televise this event in Mecca, but it was refused.
Shame on you, you did misquote me. I did not say that God is a person, the Son is a person, the Holy Ghost is a person, and they are one person. I didn't say that. I said there is one God, not one person. It seems to me they're televising it. I see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 cameras. You said they're not televising it? They're televising it, aren't they? I'm a little confused. I don't understand.
Do you give us permission for everyone interested in obtaining a copy of this event, a video?
Yes, we will certainly do that, providing that you do not edit the tapes. You see, I know a little bit about television, and you can make anyone say just about anything you want them to say by chopping it up. We are experts at that, Mr. Deedat. And I would trust this man. Are you looking at me, sir? I trust you. But I don't trust the whole world that I do not see. And we ask to sign a statement if you wanted to televise it and take it with you, do whatever you want to do with it, providing that you tell us where you are going to edit it and how you're going to cut it up. I think that's only fair. We would not want to take anything he said and chop it up and make him to seem to say something that he did not say. That wouldn't be right nor fair. And I think that we've been just about as Christian as anyone could ever be with it.